Lower anterior resection syndrome, also known as LARS, afflicts many patients that have had part of their colon and or rectum removed during a lower anterior resection surgery. In this video, I'll talk about what exactly LARS is, help you to determine whether or not you may have it, and give you some tips to help cope with it and hopefully help improve your quality of life. How do I know about LARS? My name is Jelena, and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer in 2016. As part of my treatment, I had LAR surgery, also known as a lower anterior resection, and had part of my colon and rectum removed, as well as surrounding tissue and lymph nodes to get all of the cancer out of my body. I ended up with a temporary ileostomy to allow the resected site a chance to heal. Then 7 months later, I had that reversed. Ever since then, I've struggled with my bowel movements, and it wasn't until almost a year later that I even knew that LARS was a thing. First, let me explain what exactly LARS is. As I mentioned earlier, LARS stands for Lower Anterior Resection Syndrome. It's a collection of symptoms that patients experience after having a portion of their colon and or rectum removed. Those symptoms include frequency / urgency of stools due to the fact that you have less space to store them, clustering of stools, defined as numerous bowel movements over a few hours, stool incontinence, constipation for a few days, followed by multiple bowel movements a few days later, increased gas, and abdominal pain. A LARS sufferer can have all of these or some of them and experience them daily or occasionally. Personally, I experience about half of them: frequency and urgency of stools, clustering of stools, and increased gas. Now, it's important to understand that immediately after your ostomy reversal surgery, it's perfectly normal to experience severe LARS symptoms. As your body heals and gets used to using the new digestive tract that you have, your symptoms should begin to lessen as the weeks go by. But that doesn't mean that within a few weeks, the symptoms will clear up completely. It can take months or even years for your body to settle into what your new normal will feel like, and even then, things can still change. I'm more than 5 years out from my reversal, and I feel like I'm still surprised by a few bad days in a row every now and then, followed by many good days. How can you tell if you're suffering from LARS? I found one study that was done that compared a specialist's versus patient's perspective on bowel dysfunction after rectal cancer treatment, and that study came up with a questionnaire that would determine potentially how severe a patient's LARS is. It's only 5 questions, and each question just has 3 answers to choose from. But each answer is worth a certain amount of points, so grab a pen and paper so that you can keep track, or pull up the calculator or notes app on your phone to keep track of your score. So let's get started. Question number 1. Do you ever have occasions where you cannot control your gas? A. No, never, which is 0 points. B. Less than once a week, which is 4 points. Or C, yes, more than once a week, which is 7 points. Question number 2. Do you ever have accidental leakage of liquid stool? A, no, never, 0 points. B, yes, less than once a week, 3 points. C, yes, at least once a week, 3 points. How often do you open your bowels? A, more than 7 times per day, which is within 24 hours. 4 points. B, 4 to 7 times per day, 2 points. 1 to 3 times per day, 0 points. Less than once per day, 5 points. Question 4. Do you ever have to open your bowels again within an hour of your last bowel opening? A, no, never, 0 points. B, yes, less than once a week, 9 points. C, yes, at least once a week, 11 points. Question 5. Do you ever have such a strong urge to open your bowels that you have to rush to the toilet? A, no, never, 0 points. B, yes, less than once a week, 11 points. C, yes, at least once a week, 16 points. Now add up your score. If you've scored from a 0 to 20, you're considered to have no LARS. A score of 21 to 29 means you're probably experiencing minor LARS. A score of 30 to 42 means that you're probably watching this video on the toilet. Just kidding, A little bit. It means that you probably have severe LARS. Lately, I'm scoring a 23. Mostly because of question 5, but I was generous and only answered B for that one. For question 1, I answered never because the gas never accidentally slips out of me. I know when it's coming, but it's definitely increased and it smells more potent. My husband came up with the name surgically enhanced farts because they've been much more different and more frequent ever since I had LAR surgery. Minor LARS for me means that most people outside of my immediate family don't even notice that there's anything wrong with me. If they're in close contact with me for a while, they may notice the smell of one of those surgically enhanced farts that come out silently, but the smell cannot be hidden. If I'm staying with extended family members, they may notice that I can disappear sometimes for extended periods of time to go to the bathroom. But I'm good at trying my best to hide it as much as I can from people outside of my family. Now that we've covered what LARS is and a way to determine how severe yours is, let's talk about 9 solutions, or rather, ideas that you can try to help improve your quality of life. Most of these suggestions should be discussed with your doctor before trying them, especially if the reason that you're experiencing these symptoms is because you've recently had the surgery that is causing these issues. The first 3, though, are totally fine for you to experiment with without talking to your doctor. Suggestion 1 is to make sure that you're chewing your food very thoroughly when you eat. Your digestive system has been shortened, so it may not have adjusted yet and know how to fully digest your food in that shortened tract. Chewing up your food really well will help it be digested better and potentially not overwhelm your colon as much. Tip number 2 is to avoid caffeine and alcohol. If you're a regular coffee drinker, you may have already experienced how it can make you regular after drinking that first morning cup. So if you add coffee to someone that is already experiencing loose stools, you end up with someone that's experiencing urgent loose stools. Alcohol is also known to worsen the quality of your stools. Number 3, carry a survival pack. This doesn't really help your symptoms at all, but helps you deal with them when you're out of the house. Important items to keep in your pack can vary from person to person, where you're going, and how long you're planning on spending outside of the house. Some basic things that you'll want to keep in this survival pack are extra pair of underwear, some hand sanitizer, and wipes. Some bonus things that you may also want to include are plastic bag, trash bag to put soiled items in for disposing of or bringing home. Some medication to slow things down. I take them out of the blister pack because I don't always have scissors on me and I can't open those without scissors. Some cream, some ointment for your bum if you need it. And maybe a pair of shorts or pants to change into as well. Now to some things that you should probably talk with your doctor about before trying. Number 4, probiotics. Your digestive system has been through a lot, especially if you've been through radiation and chemotherapy. So that delicate balance of good bacteria in your digestive tract has probably been disrupted. Introducing good bacteria via probiotics can help rebalance your system and potentially help it digest your food better when everything is in sync. I was told by my chiropractor and acupuncturist that I should try to find a probiotic that had as many strains as possible in it and one that needed to be refrigerated. Then my gastroenterologist recommended a specific high-potency probiotic that you could get over-the-counter at Costco. This is why it's important to talk with your doctor about this, because they can recommend what type of probiotic would be best for your body. Number 5, try eating smaller, more frequent meals. This one can go either way. The theory behind this one is when there's less food for your system to digest, it won't get as overwhelmed. But then on the flip side, if you're eating more often, your digestive system never really gets a break, so that may not help as well. So that's why experimentation is important with a lot of these. Number 6, diet changes. If diarrhea is your issue, try eating some foods that will help firm up your stool. The most common of these foods are bananas, white boiled rice, white pasta, white bread, marshmallows, tapioca, peanut butter, potatoes, cheese, yogurt, and pretzels. If you're experiencing constipation, Or you just want to have a list handy of foods that can cause looser, more frequent stools? Here's that list for you. Cabbage, onions, spinach, dried and fresh beans, peas, corn, Brussels sprouts, broccoli, grapes, apricots, peaches, plums, prunes, caffeine, beer, red wine, sorbitol, bran, milk and other dairy products, greasy foods, and prune, orange, and grape juice. Whew, that is a lot. Experiment with the foods on the list because everyone reacts a little different to foods, so some of these may trigger you and others may not. Right after I had my ileostomy reversal surgery and was going to the bathroom 20 plus times a day, I changed my diet to include a lot of those foods that will firm up your stools. But at my follow-up appointment, my surgeon got upset with me for changing my diet to that. Well, I was upset at him for forcing me to be on this diet that most other surgeons highly recommend against after an ostomy reversal surgery, which led to the misery of me basically living on the toilet for days on end and enduring the horrible burning that happens when you're passing diarrhea all the time. He agreed to let me do this seventh item if I switched back to my normal diet. Number 7, medications. Imodium, also known as loperamide, can help if you're experiencing loose stools and or clustering. Metamucil, also known as psyllium husk, can help with bulking up your stools if they're loose, which also can help minimize clustering. If loperamide isn't strong enough, there's also Lomatil, which requires a prescription. The difference between the two is that loperamide slows the gut, Lomatil both slows the gut and dries up body fluids. For me, I take Metamucil daily and I only add a little bit of water to it to get the greatest bulking action out of it. Most days, this is enough to limit me to just one episode of diarrhea a day, but if I go a second time and feel like more on the way, I'll take an Imodium to really slow things down. Number 8, pelvic floor therapy. Your pelvic floor muscles and connective tissue support the bowel and bladder, plus the muscles help with the function of those. So if you're having continence issues, pelvic floor therapy could help. Just like physical therapy for a broken bone, an injury, or pain, one session isn't going to fix it all. So be patient and look for an improvement in your symptoms over time. And finally, number 9, enemas. You definitely need to talk to your doctor about doing this before deciding to do them on your own. They are time consuming, but they can allow all of the stool to be cleared out of your bowels so that you can function for the day. These should be used as a last resort if all of the other interventions have been attempted and haven't given you the quality of life that you need. And you've given your body months, if not years, to fully heal from that reversal surgery. You need to be off treatment to try these, which if you're listening to me and talking to your doctor about this before starting, they should let you know this as well. There's also the danger of accidentally puncturing your rectum or your colon while doing these, which then leads to stool leaking into your abdominal cavity, which is obviously very bad. This is why you need to talk to your doctor before beginning these, get their approval, and then find out from them what the danger or warning signs are that you need to watch out for if things start going bad. One of the studies that I read about LARS, published in the National Institutes of Health, noted in the conclusion, and let me read this for you so I don't get it wrong, more research on the basic science behind colonic motility, feedback mechanisms, and compensatory factors would prove useful for eventual development of novel techniques to treat LAR syndrome. So scientists and doctors are still pretty clueless on just the basic functions of how our bowels work. So it kind of makes sense that they aren't very helpful when we go to them to try and get some relief or some help with these symptoms we're experiencing. Hopefully, this research will become a priority soon, and some advances will be made that will help not only colorectal cancer patients suffering from LARS, but others that suffer from various bowel and digestive disorders. If you've found another solution to help with dealing with your LARS, please consider sharing it in the comments below to help other fellow LARS sufferers. Living with LARS is tough, so I hope that I've given you at least one new idea to try and shown you that you're not alone in what you're experiencing. To learn more about what you might expect after an ostomy reversal, check out the playlist up here, or check out the video below here that YouTube thinks you'd enjoy from my channel. Thank you for watching.